Here we go for the next free Active Directory training video for the 7640 course. In this video, I will look at the five Operation Master roles that are found in Active Directory. Active Directory is a multi-master replication system, but some operations are best performed on one server at a time. By having these operations performed in one place at a time, this allows one server to be responsible for these changes. Having the operation only on the one server ensures that when an operation is performed, the result is consistent across all the Active Directory databases and also eliminates the possibility of replication conflicts. In Active Directory, there are five operational master roles, otherwise known as FISMO roles. FISMO stands for Flexible Single Master Operation. Some of these master roles work on the whole forest, and others work at the domain level. You are free to move these operational master roles from one domain controller to another domain controller. When deciding which domain controllers these roles should be on, it is important to ensure that they are available when required. If an operational master role is not available, certain Active Directory operations can fail. Depending on the operational role, it may affect either a single domain or the entire forest. I will start with the forest-wide roles, of which there are two. The first role is the Schema Master. The Schema Master contains the layout or structure of all the data in the Active Directory database. For example, a user account by default can include information such as the person's job title and phone numbers. If, for example, you wanted to add a person's pay grade, you could change the schema to include this information. Some software, such as Exchange, will expand the schema to fit more information in. Making changes to the schema is a very important decision because once you add additional attributes or objects to the Active Directory database, they cannot be removed. Since the schema defines the Active Directory database across a forest, there is only ever one schema operation role per forest. If the server with the schema role is not present, then you cannot make changes to Active Directory schema. If you want to test changes to the schema before trying them in your production environment, you would first create a new forest in a test environment. If you want to make schema changes in an environment with multiple forests, you would need to make a change to all the schema masters in all the different forests. Once a change is made on the domain controller holding the schema master role, the schema master is responsible for ensuring that this change is replicated to the other domain controllers. The next forest-wide operational master role is the domain naming master. The domain naming master is used whenever you add a domain or remove a domain from the forest. The domain naming master ensures that two domains are not added with the same name. If the domain naming master is not available, you will not be able to add or remove any domains in the forest. Once again, this role is only on one domain controller in the forest. Due to the schema master and domain naming master not being used very often, Microsoft recommends both of these roles be stored on the same server for ease of administration. The last three operational master roles are domain-wide. For each domain in your forest, you will have three of these operational master roles. The first of these three operational master roles is the RID master. The RID master, RID standing for relative identifiers, is responsible for allocating RID pools. These RID pools are essentially a lot of sequential numbers used in SIDs. Every object in Active Directory has a SID, or Security Identifier, associated with it. This SID is basically a unique number which Active Directory uses to identify the object. Every user account will have a SID, and also a username associated with it. The username is used by us humans, as it is easy for us to remember. The SID is used by Windows, as computers work better with numbers. Since Active Directory user accounts primarily work against a SID, this is why you can easily change a username and not have to change any of the permissions associated to that user. Any file that has permissions assigned to that user will be referenced back to that SID. When a username changes, Windows will simply display the new username that is associated with that SID. If you delete a user or an object in Active Directory, that SID is lost. Even if you straight away create a new user account with the same name, the SID will be different, and thus the new user account will not have any of the access that the old user account had. The RID master gives out relative IDs which are part of the SID. To demonstrate how the RID forms part of a SID, I will open a command prompt on my domain controller. From the command prompt, I will run a query that will show all the user SIDs in my domain. Since this is a new domain, there aren't too many users created as yet. Notice that all the SIDs listed here have a number appended on the end, starting with 500. This is the relative ID. The relative ID is a sequence of numbers that is allocated by the RID master. Having said this, the RID master gives out relative IDs in blocks. For this reason, you don't need a super fast connection back to the RID master. Also, a domain controller will request more relative IDs from the RID master before it runs out. If the RID master is down for a little while, it should not have an impact on your organization. Having said this, you would want to make sure the outages are small, as if the RID master is down and your servers run out of relative IDs, no new objects in Active Directory can be created. Keep RID master availability in mind if you have a need to create a lot of Active Directory objects at once. For example, if you need to create a large amount of user accounts at once, you don't want your domain controller to run out of relative IDs halfway through the process of creating a large amount of users and the RID master is not contactable. The next domain-wide role is the PDC emulator. The PDC emulator, or Primary Domain Control Emulator, was originally put in place to provide a bridge between Windows 2000 domain controllers and Windows NT domain controllers. In a Windows NT domain, changes could only be made on the primary domain controller. When you upgraded a domain from Windows NT to a Windows 2000 domain, any Windows NT domain controllers left in the domain could only communicate with the PDC emulator. Back in those days, it was a very important role. Nowadays, it is unlikely that you will have any Windows NT domain controllers, and in fact, Windows NT domain controllers are not supported when you install a Windows Server 2008 domain controller. Even though the need of the PDC emulators is deprecated, it still does perform some important tasks in your domain. The first task that the PDC emulator is responsible for is keeping the time accurate in the domain. Usually, you would ensure your PDC emulator is syncing its time with an official external time source. These official external time sources are very accurate as they usually use an atomic clock to keep time. Atomic clocks are the most accurate clock ever built. Microsoft keeps a list of trusted external time clocks on their website. It is best to use the closest of these official time sources to your site to keep your PDC emulator time accurate. The other domain controllers in the domain will sync their time off the PDC emulator. The clients on the network will, in turn, sync their time from their local domain controller. For this reason, it is important to ensure that the clock on your PDC emulator is as accurate as possible, as all other computers in your domain will directly or indirectly get their time from it. The next task the PDC emulator performs is when a password is changed in the domain. When a password is changed, the password is replicated to the PDC using urgent replication. This means the PDC emulator is considered the most up-to-date source of password changes. For this reason, if an incorrect password is given to a domain controller, the domain controller can contact the PDC emulator, who will have the final say if that user is allowed on the network with that password. If you are using Distributed File System, or DFS, The PDC emulator plays an important part in keeping DFS up to date and consistent. When changes are made to DFS, these changes are made on the PDC emulator. If this causes too much load, which can occur on large DFS implications, this can be disabled so the PDC emulator is not required to make DFS changes. Lastly, when you modify group policy, the group policy editor will automatically default to the PDC emulator and make the changes there. You can change this and use a different domain controller, but it is important to understand that this is the default location. The idea being the changes are made on the PDC emulator and replicated out to the other domain controllers. Keep this in mind if you have just changed group policy and the change does not seem to have taken effect. To speed up the process, you may need to perform a manual replication or change the group policy editor to a different domain controller to make changes. The last of the five roles is the Infrastructure Master role. This role is important for keeping changes in object references consistent across domains. It does things such as track object moves, renames, and deletes across domains. It also updates multi-domain references in Active Directory when changes occur. If you are using a single forest with a single domain, the following does not apply. If you are using multiple domains, you need to consider the following when placing your Infrastructure Master. In a multi-domain environment, the Infrastructure Master updates references to multi-domain objects when changes occur. If the domain controller holding the Infrastructure Master role is a global catalog server, this can cause problems. This occurs because when the Infrastructure Master finds a change, it refers to the local global catalog, which will always be up to date. Since the Infrastructure Master thinks the change has already been made, it will not notify any other domain controllers a change has occurred. To fix the problem, ensure that all domain controllers in the forest are global catalog servers, so they always have up-to-date changes. If you cannot do this, make sure the Infrastructure Master is not a global catalog server. Remember that if you are using a single forest and a single domain, you don't need to worry about this. This problem only occurs in a multi-domain environment. This concludes how the five Operation Master roles work in Active Directory. In the next video, I will look at how you can move these roles around from domain controller to domain controller. Thanks for watching our always free training videos.